Connected Bhavava Trap, page 19. Relationship between neighbors, especially when it's come to harhaka, for a distance, when there's a damage involved. That's the key subject of today. Many halachic implications we're going to derive from lesson today. Some examples: someone live in a neighborhood and he brought some type of bees or bees swab or something that can cause the neighbor to be bitten. Or the issue we discussed yesterday, if you remember, the relationship between the two, the honey and the masters. One of my rabbeim years back brought seven reasons for the decisions we discussed yesterday, the combination of chardal and dvash. Now, in general, the subject is a interaction between man and his fellow, and obviously when it's come to Jewish law, there are many rabbinic writings and inputs to make sure that people keep a relationship properly, and that's the beauty of a study Jewish law and study in general the subject of rabbinic writings and oral teachings, because it shows you that in Judaism we go deep down to the even the small, appear like a small minute things of relationship between the two. Those days, for example, they used to do laundry. Nowadays it's easy. You drop your laundry either in the washing machine or your laundromat, or there are those who even drop it by the window. You look out in West Street next to Western Hotel, you see a huge business like those drive by, right? You drop your laundry and you move on, and then you come back to the window and you have it ready. Ancient time, Talmudic time, we are back about 1800 years ago, they used to have a special cistern or a special well in the, not a deep one, but in the size that people used to put their laundry in a special, some type of tab. And it was two separate tabs. The first one, they used to put the laundry and combined it. It's called brechat chimtzun, combined it with some materials that cause the laundry to, like in the modern days, the detergent. Those days it was even in the tzoat klavim, in such a way it's hard for us to comprehend, but was the ancient time they did it. And the second one, they used to rub it, meshafshafim, and put it in the second a tub. That's the way they used to do laundry in the Talmudic time. Obviously, between the materials, the smell, and more, can be an issue of neighbors. So we're going to talk about it. Another thing is the issue of channels. My officer, years back in the army, he used to be a high officer in the in those units that get to North Egypt, North Africa, North Egypt, doing Yom Kippur War. So he said that most of the soldiers came back with those malaria or those different diseases because it was those te'alot, those type of kind of tabs or swamp that contain all this water that was basically contaminated. And he described how in the headquarters, Kirya, in Tel Aviv, there are many doctors that struggle with that because the soldiers came back with a red ababuot, which is like some type of the terminology, some type of a disease. But anyway, when it's come to this type of issues, especially when it's implemented in an area between neighbors, can be a serious issue. Yes, the Talmuds go to a small details, even issue of urinating. Yes, someone does that on the property of his neighbor. how you treat it and what. Or planting a tree. We explained in the past several days that you have to have a distance, right? That's the whole goal of this chapter. But there are sometimes the roots of the tree can go further to your neighbor estate that exceeded sometimes, as we said, is 3 handbreadth or whatever the minimum distance, can exceed it to that and cause damage. It's a matter of fact that one of my friends, he had this septic, this pipeline, sewer pipeline that comes out of his estate, and the tree, it turns, you have a lot of sewer issue, and the tree, old tree, the roots of that tree went and penetrate to those old pipes and caused all this sewer line to back up and damage. So he needs to not only cut the roots, but cut the tree, cut the root, cut the pipe, dig in the big part of his yard, replace the pipeline, and that was the only way for him, with all these permits, huge expense and huge time, and just to get rid of those roots of the trees that penetrate to those old pipes. So with that said, we're going to discuss this serious subjects of between man and his fellow, Tractate Bava Batra, page 19, 2 lines from the top of the page. V'lo yachpor adam bo, the Mishnah said, v'lo nivrechet hakovsin, not the launderer pool, only if he distance from that 3 handbreadth. Why? Because the launderer pool, brechat maim mezika et hakotel, cause damage to the wall. So that's the reason why the rabbi said a distance between the two has to be 3 handbreadth. Amar Rav Nachman Amar Rabba Bar Avuah, lo shanu ela min ha-mechamtzan. This idea, this obligation of having a 3 handbreadth distance, it has to be in the distance for that pool that you leave it with a dog exterminants, which is, as we explained, those days they used to do that as a form of detergent, so they combined it in those days until you reach a point that it's the detergent works well within the clothing. The problem is, while you do that process, it can carry an odor. Aval min hanadyan, as we explained earlier, there are 2 separate pools. So the second pool was the pool that they used to meshafshef. They used to take those laundry, and if you remember the old days, they used to do it by hand. Mm-hmm. So that one, you have to add one more, arba amot. You have to have a 4 cubit between the wall of your neighbor and that pool. Why? Because while you're doing shifshuf, while you're doing this type of act, it's the water running out. Tanya Namehachi, Nivrechet HaKovsin, that a launderer, when you have that tub, you have to distance for what? From the wall of your neighbor, arba amot, 4 cubits. V'ha anan tnan, we learn in the Mishnah that it's sufficient to have 3 tfachim. 3. Why here we add another notion of 4 amot? 4 amot is a huge difference. Remember, 3 tfachim is 3 handbreadth. 4 amot is a 4 cubits. El alav shmamina kerav Nachman, we derive from the ruling of Rav Nachman that holds that when the Mishnah speaks about mechamtzen, about that detergent that involved with the pool of the launderer, brechat hashriya, the first one, then you speak about solely and only the 3 handbreadth. However, when you talk about the second pool, Hanadyan, which is the pool, the tab that involved with final washing of that clothing, b'chat hashiv shuv, then it's a different category of distance, as we explained, nitazim hamayim, the water is jumping all over, and therefore you have to have a 4 cubit distance. So therefore, you see the way that we reconcile the difference between the Braita and the Mishnah. The Mishnah speaks about what? Brechat Hashraya, the laundry that involved with the original process. And therefore, since you just leave the laundry there with that old detergent, then you don't need more than 3 handbreadth. When you talk about Nadyan, which is a separate type of tab, then you need 4 cubit distance to the wall of the neighbor. Another notion of that discussion, ve'ika deramei lehu mirmei. There are those who ask this contradiction between the Mishnah and the Braita, and explains, tnan, that's the way Rav reconciled it. Nivrechet hakovsin shlosha tfachim. That's the launderer part, is the 3 handbreadth. Vehatanya arbam, or that's the question we just presented, that you see a different size of distance. As we explain, 3 handbreadth, it's close to nothing compared to 4 cubits. So he said, Amar Rav Nachman barav, Amar Rabba baravua lo kashya. Kan min ha-mechamtzan, kan min ha-nadyan. As we explained, it's a 2 separate entities of pool, and therefore we understand when you need just to take your laundry and put it in the pool and leave it there with that materials, so at klavim, then 300 is sufficient. When you talk about pool nadyan, that you need to actively move your clothing around, then you need the 4 cubits. Rav Chiya Breid Rav Avya Matnela Behedya, he explained this limitation, and he said the person should not dig that breichat kovsin, the launderer, close to the pit of his neighbor, Ela hi mirchik misfat mechamtzan velakote shlosha tfachim. He circumscribed that ruling by saying that he needs to distance 300 from the wall to that pool. We learn in the Mishnah, a person should not dig a pit close to the pit of his neighbor, only if he distance from that wall 300, vesad besid. The idea is he applies lime to its wall. Ibaya lehu. Here is the question they present. Vesad besid tnan, the Mishnah that said that he applies lime, o dilma o sad besid tnan. We said or, which is the, here we have Vav HaChibu. The difference is the letter Vav, which means you mean to say that you distance 3 handbreadth and then you apply lime, or you say that it's in addition. So it means you have to have 3 handbreadth distance and you have to apply lime. So again, the question is with or? With applying limes or applying limes. What exactly involved in the requirement, the Chatam Sofer said, of that distance? Obviously, the Rabben Yonah said that it has to be a clear girsa. So the question is, do you take this Vav Achibu, the letter Vav, which is end, as a mean of with or? That's the Tosfot on page 17a. Elaborates. So they said pshita. Now the Gemara tried to reconcile that predicament by bringing the idea that divsad besid knatnan, that he applies lime. Why? The isal kadatach de osad besid knan. If you go by the version that it means either or he apply limes. So im ken le arvinhu velit ninhu. So you have to combine and touch together for the text. In the second clause is certainly or he apply line. So from the fact that the Mishnah separates these two clauses, it is evident that the first clause reads ve and he apply line. Now, the Gemara did not get this idea, especially the Chatam Sofer said that it's hard to go that you have to have this requirement. Even if they, you see in the both close the same ruling, here with the Gemara rejected and said Dilma Mishum Delo Damei Hai Hezeika Lehai Hezeika. You cannot compare the two type of damage to each other, meaning that the first example, the first clause is a total different than the second bava, the second clause. Why? Reisha, the first one, Heizeka Dimtuna. The first one is the issue of moisture damage. How many of you know when you have issue of the kids have allergy, they sneezing, etc., you know that it's most probably from a basement or water-related moisture issues. You can call it allergy, you can call it all kind of dust mite or other form, but it's they relate to lachut, to moisture issues. And especially in a building property, even in modern days, can be a severe issue of creating even a viruses or asthma diseases and others. Seifa behezeka de havla. Hevla meaning the damage that come out of heat. You remember yesterday we talked about bakery, and we explained that the person prohibited to have a bakery business next door to a storage house that contain some type of crop or other things that can be damaged by the heat that coming out of that bakery. Bakery can create that, not just the oven or the stove, whatever they have there, the food itself, but the heat is a separate damage. So the Rashba explains that the heat issue is much serious issue. Most probably it's because in that time it's involved with consequent damage that, as far as we know, it's a damage that can be a permanent damage. Here, many Rishonim hold that the reason you distance, as we explained yesterday, it's because it's weakening the land, weakening the land. But the truth is, the way you dig in, the run, many others hold that the issue is either moisture or heat or even both, according to Rabbeinu Nissim. So the Gemara tried to reconcile that dilemma, that quandary, and they said, Tashma Rabbi Yehuda Omer, Sela Haba Beyadayim, if the soil between the neighboring properties is so soft that it comes away in one's hand. So it means, as we explained on page 17, it can be mitporer, it can be just, you touch it, you know, the difference between a strong rock and rock that combined with water for a long time, right? The moment you touch it, any one of you would ever visit the Dead Sea or the Ein Gedi, you see all those places, they have a these mud or other things that people put even around the body. It looks like a rock. The moment you put your hand, it's so soft that it can spoil in your hand. So they said, Ze chofer boro mikan, veze chofer boro mikan, which is each neighbor can dig his pit in one side of that boundary, meitzar. And he said, Ze marchik shloshat fachim vesad besid, The first one, let's call him name, Reuven, he distanced three hand breadth and combined it with application of lime to its wall. וזה מרחיק שלושה תפחים, וסד בסיד, and the other neighbor have a distance of three hand breadth and combined it with applies to lime to its wall. From the fact that the brayta specified soft as opposed to a regular soil, the Gemara deduced and said, Ta'ama deva beyadayim. The reason that you have two requirements, which is what? The distance of the three hand breadth and the apply limes. It's because we are speaking here about soft soil. Ha lo ba beyadayim, but in the case of soil that does not come away in one's hand, it is not necessary to effect both measures. So what do you derive from that? That the first, the reisha, the first clause of the Mishnah, which speak about a average regular soil, mentions the application of lime as a what? An alternative option. So they said, the Gemara rejected that and said, Hu hadin de afal gav de loba beyadayim name sad besid. You can say that it speak about a regular type of soil that you have to add in order to distance the potential damage by applying lime. In addition, uva biyadayim istrichele. Yes, it was necessary for the brayta to specify soil that comes away in one's hand. For had it not done so, salka de'atach amina. Kivan deva beyadayim. Since the soil comes away in one's hand, liba'ei ravchat fei, a gap larger than three tfachim, three hand breadth, is required. Kamash melan, so therefore, the brayta informs us that a gap of three hand breadth is suffice, even with regard to soil that comes away in one's hand. So Rabbeinu Asher in the Siman Dalet said that this quandary in the Gemara was not reconciled, and therefore if a person distance according to the Rosh three hand breadth or apply limes, you cannot enforce him to do more than that. Why? Because what we learn, if it's a safek mamon, if it's something that involves with monetary question, hamotzi mechaveiro alav haraya, the burden of the proof lie upon who? The one who wants, claim that he wants something that someone else wants, and therefore we are lenient upon the defender. However, the Maimonides, the Rambam in Hilchot Shchenim, chapter 19, hold that you have to have both. You have to have a distance of three hand breadth, and you have to apply limes as well. And the Magid Mishneh said, the reason it's because the language of the Gemara here in this sugiya, vesad besidnan. That's the way, by the way, the Rashba and the Ritva go along with the Rambam. The R said that they understand the Rambam differently, that the Rambam hold that the Gemara did not reconcile this pratigment, and therefore, in the response I call Avodat HaGershuni, he said that you have to have these two requirements, the way that the Rambam hold that you have to have both the three hand breadth and the ply lines. It's because the Rambam did not get the point that the Gemara reconciled this question. That's the way Hagayot Maimonides hold, and the many Achronim hold the whole idea of the Rambam prohibition of damaged neighbors is a framework of a Rambam that hold that it's a biblical. Listen carefully, it's a biblical. And if you talk as a safek de oraita, if something that it's a may be a violation of Torah law, therefore that's the reason why the Rambam hold stringent when it's safek de oraita lechumra. That's the Vilna Gaon said in Choshen Mishpat, chapter 155. You see in the book called Pitchei Choshen, the first chapter, he bring the source from a response of Chatam Sofer that hold in Yoreh De'a Siman Reish Mem Aleph 241, that hold the source for the Oraita by the Rambam is the Pasuk, two separate, one V'nishmartem, and the second one Lo Ta'amod Al Dar Re'echa, literally you should not stand on your fellow blood. But as we said, there are others like Rabbeinu Yonah that hold that the reason for that is the same way that we are prohibited to steal or to rob, the prohibition of lo tignov, lo tigzol, etc. The same way is the prohibition of causing damage. If you want to see more on this sugya, there is a wonderful contemporary book of the late Rabbi Bloy. It's called Pitchei Choshen. At the first chapter, on his commentary, you see all this discussion. What's the real source of this idea of Rambam that hold that is fake deoraita, that it's most probably a notion of potential violation of biblical precept? The Mishnah continues, "Mamchikin et hagefet ve'et hazevel ve'et hamelach." Some said ve'et hasid ve'et haslaim. We basically distance all this list, olive refuse, manure, salt, and flint stones must be kept a distance of at least three handbreadth, three tfachim, from the brick wall of one's neighbor. Now, the Mishnah mentioned all these different materials in one time because all of them has a potential in the sages' experiences to damage the wall by the heat that comes out of those materials. Now the Gemara brings other source of Mishnah that speaks about certain materials that adds a heat, and they try to show in a manner of juxtaposition that there is a difference between the two. Tnan Hatam, there is a Mishnah we study in Tractate Shabbat, page 47b. Over there, when it's come to Isu Hatmana, when it's come to the wrapping on Shabbat, there are certain things the Mishnah said, Bametomnim uvame entomnim, with what materials may one wrap hot food before the Shabbat, and what materials may one not wrap hot food before Shabbat. Obviously, we know that there are certain things that contain certain heat that preserve it for a long time. Takes, for example, the old days that they used to wrap with pillows or wrap with blankets, certain things, and it preserves the heat. So he said, entomnin, לא בגפת ולא בזבל ולא במלח ולא בסיד ולא בחול בין לחים בין יבשים. One may not wrap with olive refuse, manure, salt, lime or sand, regardless if they are wet or dry. מה ישנה חחד דקטני סנאים ולא קטני חול? So when you try to juxtapose the two different sources, why you differentiate between the Mishnah here that speaks about what? Stones, but not sand. Uma Mishnah hatam dektan echol velo katan islaim, that over there they mention sand, but not stones. So Rav Yosef reconciled it, and he said there is a certain exclusion of flint stones from the Mishnah about wrapping foods. Amar Rav Yosef, lefi she'en darkan shel bnei adam lehatmin baslaim. In a general practice, in those days, people did not do that, did not wrap food with flint stones. Tosfot explained that that heat will not preserve for a long time. It's coming out of the flint stone and not stay longer. Amar le Abayeir, Abayeir said to Rav Yosef, v'chi darkan shel bnei adam lehatmin begizei tzemer ulshonot shel argaman. You mean to say that people wrap food with wool shearings or strips of purple wood? The Tanya, we learn in Tractate Shabbat, page 48, תומנין בגזי צמר ובציפי צמר ובלשונות של ארגמן ובמוחין. You see here a different way that they use to wrap, and one may wrap food with wool shearings, combed wool, strips of purple wood, or tuffet of wool. ואין מטלטלין אותן, but you're not allowed to carry, to move them on Shabbat. Why? Since we explain that there is a mukzeh that we set aside for melechet gadim, for this type of work with the clothing. So since en darkan, it's not a usual matter to wrap them with that, so the question is why we not mention the flint stones here. So they said that Amar Abayei Yagid Alav Reod. There is a pasuk, there is a verse in the book of Iyov, Job, chapter 36, that he said, one shed lights on the other, which means here the Tana wants to be succinct in his expression, and he did not express all different materials because he figured out that a person should teach his fellow over other things as well. Tana hachaslahim vehu adin lechol. Tana hatamchol vehu adin leslahim. Meaning, you mention one thing in one place, and people understand the others. So in one place you mention flint, stone, and they understand sand from that. The other place you mention sand, and people understand that that's also applies to flint stones. So Rava challenged this answer of Abayei. Amar le Rava, I yagid alav re'o, if you tell me that people just express it and teach each other, litninhu lechulhu bechada. So you should mention either over there or in this Mishnah all this list, and velitnei chada minayhu beidach. And we mention only one of them in the other Mishnah, and by doing so, guess what? Vehu adin leidach, and people understand that the same ruling applies to all other materials. Ela amarava haynu tama delo katan eslaim mishum dim shatkei leilik deira. The reason is that they are break the pot and therefore are never used for insulation. So that's the way the Rashi explained the word mishtekei. Others that say that it can cause chaluda, can cause all kind of ruining. The heat that come out of those flint stones, Rabbeinu Tam said, can ruin the food. So they said, "El amarava hatam haynu ktana de lo ktana eslaim mishum mishtakel legdera hacha haynu tama de lo ktana echol mishum demichamemei chayim umikarirei karir." So the reason that not mentioned sand here in the Mishnah is that the sand heats only items that are warm to begin with, and items that are cold in the leaves cold. So it means that the sand has no damaging effect on a cold wall. That's the way the Ritva explains. The sand did not ruin the wall. So veha tane Rabbi Oshaya chol. Rabbi Oshaya taught in Baita that this includes sand. So it means the opposite, that the sand can damage the wall. So they said hatam over there in Rabbi Oshaya Baita, you talk about soft. The wet sand, it's called bimtuna. So they said, so it's not something that can damage by the heat. So the Gemara challenges said, Tana didan namelitnei v'likumei bimtuna. So our Tana should also mention that they we apply to wet sand. So they explain, ha Tana lei, when we talk about distance, they said amat hamaim, the irrigation channel. So it means anything that can be moisture, we have to have a distance. So there's no need to mention wet sand. So Gemara rejected. Atu milo katane amat hamaim, katane nivrechet hakovsim. The Tana did not teach the requirement to distance and irrigation channel. And yet, in addition, he mentioned a launderer's pool, even though it too causes damage through moisture. So by the same token, he could have mentioned wet sand as well. So the Gemara said, Hanhu tzrichei. We need both the amat hamayim and the irrigation channel and nivrechet hakovsim, the lender's pool. The itana, amat hamayim mishum dikvia, because it's permanent, this type of irrigation channel. Aval nivrechet hakovsim lo kvia. But when you talk about launderer's pool, it's not permanent. Sometimes the launderer changed to other type of a omanut, other type of based on the Perusha Mishnah of the Rambam, they said that it's not permanent only at the time of laundering. Eimalo, so you're not. You may say that you don't have to have the distance. Ve'itana nivrechet hakovsin, and if we mention only the launderer pools, one might have thought that the only launderer pool need to distance because its water is stagnant, and thus it can cause severe water damage. Mishum dekavu vekayme, aval amat hamayim lo. But irrigation channel is, it doesn't need to have this distance. So therefore, now you see why you need both of them. The question is, so why you need to mention Siach u'me'ara, that cave? There is a Rashba and others, but most of them, Tosfot and Rashba, said that it's talk also about the depth of those pools, which means either you say that it's the way that they used to do it in those days, but the general mindset is if it's much deeper than the 3 hand breadth, it's a separate entity. Marchikin et hazra'im ve'et hamarcheisha. The Mishnah speaks about seeds, and the use of the plow must be distanced at least 3 hand breadth from the wall of one's neighbor. So the Gemara challenges and says, Zra'im, teipo klei mishum machreisha. Why did one, the Mishnah mention that seeds must be distanced 3 tfachim from the neighbor's wall? This emerges anyway from the restriction against the plow, for seeds are planted in the plow furrows. So the Gemara said, "Bemapolet yad." Here the Mishnah is speak about seeds sown with a casting of the hand into shallow holes dug with a trowel, not into plow furrows. So the Zalecha Mishneh explains that the whole idea of distance, it's because as we explained, Rifiona Adama, it's caused the land to be softened. But anyway, the Gemara said, Machreisha, V'tipuklei Mishum Zra'im. So when we speak about the plow must be distance of 3 tfachim from neighbor's wall, which will be anyway from restriction against seeds, for plow furrows are made and planting seeds. So they said, Bechoresh le'ilanot, that here those trees, and how proper is before Tu Bishvat, right? That one plows for the benefit of trees, not the plant seeds. So the Gemara said, "Veteipukle mishum maya." So the Mishnah mentioned of a restriction against seeds is necessary for it emerges anyway from the prohibition against putting water near a neighbor's wall. Since seeds cannot grow without water, they will not be planted where one cannot irrigate them. So they explained and they said, the Tana be'eretz Yisrael kaya dechtiv limtar ha-shamayim tishtei mayim. So here we talk about Eretz Israel and how proper it. We are now at the eve of Tu Bishvat. The Torah said in the book of Devarim, chapter 11, limtar ha-shamayim, it drinks the water of a rain of heaven. Rabbeinu Moshe ben Nachman, the Ramban, on this pasuk on Devarim, brought a Gemara, you see it also in Tractate Shabbat, page 32b. When you beseech God for a person who is healthy, to stay healthy, that's relatively easy. When you ask God to change destiny for a person who is not well, here you need to change the Shanot Metziut, change the very basic foundation of structure that Almighty made decision, that's much harder. So when it's come to a Egyptian Nile that was part of blessing of Yaakov to Paro, Mashke ve'ole al gdotav, that the Nile River goes above, so those, by the law of the nature, those water come into those isles. And provided, so in order to stop such a thing, they need to have a lot of sins, the Ramban said. Versus Eretz Yisrael, limtar ha-shamayim, it drinks the water of the rain of heaven. So it's enough for people to be a little beast in a sense of misbehavior, and right away they stop having rain. So therefore you see that in order to have a blessing in Eretz Israel, they have to behave properly all the times, otherwise there is a lack of water, lack of rain. And the Ramban concluded and said that's one of the sod, one of the secret, which is the effect of anything and everything that happened in Eretz Israel to the entire world. So now the Gemara hold that the reason for the restriction against sowing seeds near the wall of a neighbor is not that water damage must ensue as a result. So the Gemara now assumes that the reason seeds must be distanced from the wall is that their roots will spread sideways and loosen the earth beneath the wall. Lememra, so in a way to say, Dizraim, that the seeds. 19b, Litzdadin kamishtarshei, they spread the root sideways. Vehatnan, we learn in Tractate Kilaim in the Mishnah, chapter 7. They said, Hamavrich et agefen be'eretz, ba'aretz. So one who bent a branch of a vine and inserted into the ground, so the following laws is applied. אם אין גבה אפר שלושה תפחים לא יביא זרע עליה ותענה עליה אבל זורע את הצדדים אילך ואילך, which means that this is a rule, as long as you distance 3 hand breadth, I wish to have more time, so it means that it's not בשיפוע. So one of the things that we always said when it's come to Ashgacha, when they involve with the grapes, they have to make sure that the Geffen doesn't have the Havracha. Amar Rabbi Chaga b'shem Rabbi Yosi, mpnei shemachlidin et hakarka umaalin afar tichuach. It says because the roots will break up the ground directly beneath the seeds, causing soft soil to rise to the surface. So this is run causes or weakening of the soil upon which the wall stands. Now, Rabbeinu Hananel said that it's like chulda that live in those holes, so that's the reason you have to have a distance. ומרחיקים את מרגליים מן הכותל שלושה תפחים. You have to distance the urine 3 hand breadth. אמר רבא בבר חנה, מותר לאדם להשתין מים מצד כולו של חברו, דכתיב, ויחרתי לאחיו משתין בקיר ועצוב ועזוב בישראל. So here it means that it's not damaged the unit, not damaged the wall. ואנן תנן ומרגליים מן הכותל שלושה תפחים. So it said, הטעם בשופכים, the Mishnah is referred to a urine pour from the chamber pot, not the act of urination. So obviously, that's the way Rashi said. The Rimigash and Miri said that is a difference between do it bevatachat, one time or process. But anyway, Tashma lo yishpoch adamayim mitzad kol lo shchabu alam kin lechigim lo shlosha tfachim. So the namin beshofchim. Tosfot ask. So if that type of unit, we understand why the Mishnah said, but when it's someone who's just shofech, what's the prohibited? So he said that meraglayim unit is finished berega. Tosfot said, abal anach meraglayim kalim kerega. Tashma lo yashin adamayim. A person, the Shinaz and Rashi said that it means real direct urination. This is a brick. When it's come to a wall made of stone, what's the tefach? 100. When it's come to a rocky ground, that's even mutar. Tuvta de Rabba Bar Chana, tuvta. So this is a final refutation of Rabba Bar Chana. Vare Rabba Bar Chana kara amar. He bring a pasuk as a raya, is a clear sentence. Hatamachi ke amar, afilu mide de darkei leashune bekir lo shavkin aleihu, mein yu kalba. So that's not applied to a person, they apply to a dog. So the verse does not refer but a regular person, but a dog. The Chatam Sofer, the Torat Chaim, said that it's erased everything, so there's nothing left, there's no zecher. But kir avanim, it's enough to have tefach. And Tosfot said that that's the reason, and as we said, the Gemara left it with Tuvta.